I'm going to present is a work of my PhD entitled Hydrolases as Catalysts for Green Chemistry and Industrial Applications. Hydrolases are enzymes that catalyze the breakdown of molecules in the presence of water. They are widely used in industry. For example, in detergents, paper and pulp industry, for food, for animal feed industry, and for organic synthesis. In the current season, three hydrolases were studied. A bit and esterase from the pig liver and the allied base from Candida Antarctica was used within the spectrum of green chemistry. And a phytase from Bacillus species was studied for the potential application in feed industry. Green chemistry is about increase and decrease. Increase the use of renewable resources, safe synthetic methods, production of biodegradable product, use of catalytic reagent, and increase the atom economy of the reaction. At the same time, it aims to decrease or prevent the waste, use stoichiometric reagent, reduce the derivatization steps, and reduce the solvent or auxiliary substances. Also, it aims to reduce the energy. For efficient, for developing green chemistry, efficient metrics and tools are needed. Professor Schubert has introduced the concept of E factor, which a green metric determines or measures the waste produced by per kilogram of product. And to make the E factor more descriptive, a Q or unfriendly discussion is linked to the E factor, which describes how far the waste is hazardous.
Some tools were already reported in the literature to assess the greenness of the reaction.
For example, EHS, GreenScope, and EATIS. EATIS, or Environmental Assessment Tool for Organic Synthesis, provides four parameters for assessing the reaction. It provides a mass index and link it to the mass index and potential environmental impact of the input chemicals. Also, it evaluates the E factor of the reaction and link it to the E factor of the potential environmental impact of the waste produced. Green chemistry needs efficient catalysis, and hydrolases are perfect catalysts for green chemistry, having high chemo ratio and enantiomer selectivity, can catalyze reverse reaction in water-free conditions, and they don't need cofactor, and they can accept wide range of substrate, including unnatural molecules. So the scope of the thesis is to engineer esterase for enantiomer selective resolution of a pharmaceutical compound. Lipase catalyzes synthesis of specialty chemicals and the application of green metric tools, studying and engineering beta propeller phytase for the potential application in feed industry. And start by the first case. Clopidogrel is antiplatelet aggregation drug. It is originally released in the market under the name Dravex. And it is among the 10 best-selling drugs. The S-enantiomer is a biologically active form. Industry, it is produced as a racemic compound followed by resolution using diastereomeric agent, which is L-camphor sulfonic acid. And L-camphor sulfonic acid followed by a step of recrystallization from organic solvent and recovery by strong acid reduces the S-active product. However, this process is mass intensive. For the enzymatic resolution of racemic clopidogrel, two routes can be obtained. The first route, we can selective hydrolysis produces R-acid and the product clopidogrel, and for recycling the R acid has to be esterified and racemized. The other route reduces the R ester, and S acid, which needs esterification, and for recycling, R ester has to be racemized for recycling. We screened some of the hydrolases, and among the esterases we used for screening, Big Liver esterase showed natural selectivity with E value equal to 8. However, the Big Liver esterase is a crude, is a mixture of isoenzymes, which is not suitable for industrial application, especially in pharmaceutical. So, based on the literature found in information found in the literature, BLE1 and BLE3 were used for further studies. The homology model of BLE1, we used the homology model to study the tetrahedral intermediate form during the enzymatic catalytic mechanism. Here is the tetrahedral intermediate form between the substrate, and here is the catalytic triad of the enzyme. And first, we looked to the effect of the substrate on the C alpha backbone of our structure. We compared after molecular dynamics for one nanosecond, we measured the root mean square deviation, and we compared the tetrahedral intermediate of the S isomer for R isomer and for comparison to initial structure, and there is no significant difference between the three structures, indicating that substrate doesn't have significant impact on the C alpha backbone. So afterward, we investigated the effect of the substrate locally in the active site. As you can see here, is the substrate covalently linked to the serine, and chlorophenyl ring is located between two residues, the catalytic histidine and phenyl 407, and this location displays these side chains and prevents the catalytic histidine from forming the catalytically required hydrogen bonding to the leaving group and for the oxygen, as you see here, these two hydrogen bonds. Therefore, this interesting observation or interesting sign to be mutated to less bulky resin. So in silico mutation of this position to a smaller residue, which is alanine, shows that the positioning of the histidine is corrected and starts to form the two hydrogen bond required for the stability of the tetrahedral intermediate. At the same time, the oxanine is stabilized by two hydrogen bonding from the oxanine hole. The result shows that the BLE1 is slow, or showing slow activity, converting only 17% after 55 hours, while the mutation we developed converted 59 conversion has a 59 conversion after 10 hours, which is a significant increase. More interestingly, one of the mutations to the same position, which is leucine, showed inversion of the natural selectivity from 4 to more than 100. On the other hand, BLE isoenzyme showed natural selectivity of 10 to the R isomer. And this result concludes that BLE3 can catalyze root 1, and the mutant we developed in BLE1 can catalyze root 2. Then, I move to Libase catalyzed sensor with specialty chemicals and application of cleaning metric tools. Can be used as immobilized preparation provided by the Novozyme company and known as Novozyme 435 for production of biosurfactants and biolubricants. Mega is an anionic surfactant used for detergent preparation, and it is biodegradable and renewable, and being used formulation used in some pharmaceutical formulation which contains protein. However, it is produced in solvent system using sodium methoxide as a catalyst. For synthesis of mega compound, N-methylglucamine is reacted with isolovic acid and methylovate, and we have two functional group, an ester and amide are produced from the reaction. In presence of excessive oscillating agent, a byproduct, which is amide ester, is formed. We developed a solvent-free process for the production of omega using the combination between lauric acid and methylovate and N-methylglucamine in a molar ratio 2:1. And in comparison to the previous reports, our yield is 34%. The time course effect of the reaction shows that amide ester is the main byproduct formed during the reaction. So, to solve the problem and this increase the yield, we managed to hydrolyze the amide ester using a simple step, applying alkaline hydrolysis for the reaction division, and the final yield of 99% was obtained. We used hiatus to assess the process, which we developed process C. And we can see that the mass index and the environmental protection effect and E factor was much lower in our case in comparison to the enzymatic solvent process. And here we can see that the organic solvent used and the organic solvent process contributes to the impact, total impact of the process. Trimethylbromane oleate is used as a hydrolytic fluid and suitable for low temperature application. It is biodegradable and renewable and meets the new regulation for biolubricant. However, it is produced in solvent system using homogeneous catalyst, which require downstream processing. We convert different catalysts for production of TMB oleate, and we silica sulfuric acid as a chemical heterogeneous catalyst shows that there is a trend of decreasing reaction efficiency when we increase the acid chain lengths used. While in the case of novozyme, no detectable reaction was seen with valeric acid, and observations that novozyme also and the silica sulfuric showed higher reaction efficiency for the esterification of folate acid and trimethylglobulin. The conversion and reaction rate was much higher in case of novozyme and silica sulfuric in comparison to amperlase. However, the product obtained from the silica sulfuric is not that high in comparison to the product obtained from the novozyme. Here we can see the product, it is dark brown color, and the ester, percentage of triester content is 90%. Here is 96%. The product obtained also has a bore point of -48, which is suitable for sub-zero applications. For the reason why we obtained here the color of the product, we incubated oleic acid with silica sulfuric and a non-specific reaction is taking place, which agglutinates this double bond and generates estolite, which is responsible for this dark brown color, while in case of lipase, which is a selective catalyst, no estolite was formed. Hiatus was used to evaluate these three processes, and in case of silica sulfuric, toluene and methyl acetate needed for running the reaction, and use of solvent contributes to the final E factor and environmental potential impact of the process. While in case of the biocatalyst used, it is a solvent-free reaction, which and the total reaction showed lower E value and mass index and lower EE value. So during these two cases of biosurfactant and the biolubricant, Hiatus was used to assess the greenness of the reaction. However, we see that during this reaction, we need to PLC for assessing for determination of the reactions. And HVLC generates a lot of solvent. So it is not logic to struggle here to decrease the solvent content while we are using HVLC all over the day without developing a tool for assessing or assessing the greenness. HVLC is one of the most commonly analytical techniques in chemistry, and massive amount of waste solvent are produced. However, there is no quantitative tool for verifying the greenness of HVLC method available. HVLC-E we developed, which try to give a score for each sample run, and the score given by HVLC is depending on S or safety factor, health factor, and the environmental factor, and all of these are equivalent to the unfriendly solution which I mentioned earlier. We use the HVLC to evaluate case studies found in the literature, and here we can see that the score obtained is highly discriminated, which we can describe each of the runs with a single score. Here, for example, is one of the scores obtained from Blossett, which is more than 600, and the reason behind this score is that this entry is used as chloroform in the sample pretreatment, which is a hazard solvent, and known to be carcinogenic and other some hazards. In the last case, which I tried to show, is studying and engineering beta propellant ideas for potential application in feed industry. Phthalate is monohexahexaphosphate compound, which is hydrolyzed by phthalates into less phosphorylated compound and giving inorganic phosphates. Phthalate is a principal phosphorus storage form found in plant seeds. It collects metals such as calcium, zinc, and iron, and therefore it is considered anti-nutritional factor in seed feedstuff. Addition of phytases to animal feed will minimize the phosphorus supplementation and reduces the eutrophication problem. And the feed phytases should be referred to be thermostable, active in metal and metal-free phytate, and be active in broader pH range. Beta-propellant phytases or alkaline phytases are metalloenzymes, which have low specific activity in comparison to acid phytases, and their activity are optimal at neutral or alkaline pH. On the other hand, histidine acid phytases are found commercially for as feed additives, and they have high specific activity. However, they are not thermostable and inactive in metal phytate. We studied beta-propellant phytase from Mycelium species, and the result shows that the enzyme is showing thermostability, keeping most of its activity after incubation at 70 degrees. And also we studied the effect of different methods on the enzyme activity and stability, and we found that calcium is needed for optimal activity and stability. However, some other bivalent method can recover the enzymatic activity. In some of, in the case of iron and zinc, we couldn't detect any enzymatic activity. We investigated the effect of different kinds of methods present in the substrate, and the enzyme, the beta-propellant phytase, showed that it can hydrolyze sodium phytate and magnesium phytate, which are found also in addition to the calcium one in the feed as a component of the feed additives. So to increase the specific activity of the beta-propellant phytase, we aimed to introduce mutation in the catalytic surface and the active site. And the idea behind, the rationale behind our mutation study is we compared our enzyme to acid, to the acid phytase, and we saw that around the active site it is mainly positively charged residues, while in the case of beta propionate beta propionate phytases is mainly negative charged residues. So we produce two groups of mutation. A group of mutation is a catalytic surface which aim to reduce the negative charge by replacing glutamates with other residues. And we obtained two mutations which show this slight increase in specific activity. The mutation which we generated in the active site, on the other hand, showed decrease or loss of some of the specific activity. However, one of the mutation, which is glutamate 227, showed some interesting properties. The activity pH optimum of the mutant shifted from to the acidic side compared to the native one, and also the mutant should improve the stability in acidic media. So 80% of the residual activity was obtained was of the enzyme of the mutant obtained compared to only 40% in the case of native enzyme. So I would like to conclude my work that steric selectivity of hydrolases has a great potential in chemical and chiral industry and chiral chemistry. Use of molecular modeling and bioinformatics software are important for efficient protein engineering. Can be as powerful biocatalyst for solvent-free esterification and elongation reaction, and to provide clean products. Organic solvents are among the main contributors to the negative environmental impact of the chemical industry. And the application of efficient metrics supports the green chemistry. And combination of beta propionate phytases with acid phytases could increase the efficiency of phytate hydrolysis in the animal feed. Finally, I would like to acknowledge my supervisor, Professor Rajani Hatikol, would also like to acknowledge my co-supervisor and my co-authors, Dr. Muhammad Taqwa, Dr. Cecilia Olana, Dr. Erika Tornevar, and Dr. Kashu Mamo, and for funding from Egyptian University of Higher Education and from Erasmus Mons. And thank you.